I'll get started. So this must be a less popular topic, and it's also called misgivings. But this is kind of more of an OCAP overview type of a talk, just because it's kind of a lot of esoteric things to kind of go over, so kind of no way around it. So systemic disorders with corneal changes, and so I've organized this into inherited systemic disorders, congenital non-hereditary systemic disorders, and then other acquired causes, and I'll show lots of pictures. Okay, so these are inherited systemic conditions, and most of these are pretty rare, not all of them. So Wilson's disease is an autosomal recessive disorder with a decreased production of ceruloplasmin, which is a copper transport protein. And so you get copper accumulation in the liver and also other organs, and that leads to just overall toxicity. Usually starts earlier on in life. Ocular manifestations, as you know, the Kaiser-Fleischer ring, that's actually it's deposited in decimase membrane, and it first appears superiorly, and then it spreads 360 degrees. You can also see a sunflower cataract, and the treatment is with systemic copper chelating agents such as penicillamine. Yeah.
What's the earliest you can actually see a Kaiser-Fleischer ring?
Earliest?
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't say I've seen many. I may have seen like one or two.
Like I got a consult for a kid one time that wanted me to come rule out Kaiser-Fleischer.
Yeah, they always want to rule out Kaiser-Fleischer ring. I feel like, 99% of the time when they want that consult, there's not one.
No.
So you look and you say it's normal.
I'm just curious if there's certain age groups that yes, you could see
it. Yeah, it doesn't tell you that they're not going to get, that they aren't going to get it eventually.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So, yeah, there's a lot of consults for this, for inpatients especially. And I think today I have a patient on my schedule that's ruled out Kaiser-Fleischer ring. So it happens. But this is what it looks like. So it's kind of a dark brown or a golden ring. It does not, there's no clear zone at the limbus. So it goes all the way to the limbus. And then if you look on slit beam, you can tell that the deposition is deep. So it's that decimase membrane there. Yeah.
So if a patient were older, like an older Lamarckus generation, could you see the Kaiser-Fleischer ring through the
arcus? I can't say I've, again, this is rare. I can't say I've had that combination. I'm sure, this looks different than Arcus.
Yeah.
So I think on slip beam, you'd be able to tell. Yeah, it'd be kind of brownish, so kind of different. Sunflower cataract here is kind of a anterior subcapsular type of cataract with this particular look. So that's pretty, I guess it's something that can be seen in Wilson's disease. Next is Fabry disease. This is an X-linked lysosome storage disorder. Pretty rare. The incidence is 1 in 40,000 to 1 in 117,000 in males. It's a deficiency in alpha-galactosidase, and that leads to an inability to metabolize glycolipid ceramide trihexaside. And so that leads to deposition in the lysosomes, which impairs cellular function. See it on my screen. Okay, treatment is with enzyme replacement infusion therapy, and you can reduce the pain that they can have and risk of kidney failure and MIs and strokes with treatment. Corneal manifestations, they're usually not visually significant. Corneal verticillata are the most common. You can also see verticillata in homozygous males and heterozygous females. Other signs are dilated and tortuous conge vessels. You can see PSC cataracts. And the differential does include medication that cause corneal verticillata, which is going to be far more common than Fabry's disease. So this is what corneal verticillata look like. So it looks like verticillata that you would see with amiodarone, say. And this is deposition. These are some dilated conjunctival vessels. And so there's a deposition in the vascular endothelium, and that produces these dilated conge vessels with aneurysms. Okay, cystinosis, this is another autosomal recessive lysosome storage disease. It's 1 in 100,000 to 1 in 200,000, and there's widespread deposition of cystine crystals throughout the body, especially in the kidneys. There are infantile, juvenile, and adult onset forms. The adult onset form usually does not have kidney involvement. The treatment is with cysteamine, oral and or topical. Ocular findings, symptoms include recurrent erosions. On exam, you'll see these really, really fine corneal crystals. You might see peripheral new vascularization, band keratopathy, iris and conjunctival crystals, and retinal degeneration. The differential includes multiple myeloma. Usually, the crystals are not visually significant, but over time, I guess they could be. So this is showing some conjunctival crystal deposition, and then on the slit lamp exam on the cornea, you'll see these tiny, tiny little refractile crystals in the cornea, and they are polychromatic, so you can see different colors there. Okay, so next is a set of diseases that are mucopolysaccharidoses. These are rare inherited lysosomal storage diseases, and they're an absence of enzymes that metabolize glycosaminoglycans, and that includes dermatan sulfate, heparin sulfate, and keratin sulfate. And all of these diseases are autosomal recessive except for Hunter syndrome, which is X-linked recessive. And the way I remember this is that you imagine like a hunter kind of spotting, like kind of shooting an X-linked recessive. So that's my silly little mnemonic, which actually saves me because this tends to come up on OCAP sometimes, I think. So the other autosomal recessive diseases are Hurler's, Shays, Martolome, and San Filippo. So you'll see corneal clouding, a little bit less so in Hunter's. It usually involves the whole cornea, starting in the periphery and then progresses centrally. You can also see retinopathy and optic atrophy. You can consider corneal transplant, but they can recur. Enzyme replacement therapy is used in Shay and Hurler syndromes, and gene replacement therapy is currently being investigated. So here are some pictures of Shay syndrome, Martolome, and Hurler syndrome. So corneal clouding, starting in the periphery and then spread centrally, and here it's pretty severe. Next category are hypo and, oh, this talk is uploaded on the MedHub, so you guys can access the whole thing there. Because I know it's a lot of information to kind of dig in. Hypolipoproteinemia, so this is an abnormal reduction in serum lipoprotein levels. There's LCAT deficiency, which is lecithin cholesterol acyl transferase deficiency, Tangier's disease, Fischei disease, familial hypobetalipoproteinemia, and Bassin-Cornwhite syndrome. Only the first three of these cause corneal disease. So the corneal affecting ones are rare, they're autosomal recessive. LCAP facilitates removal of excess cholesterol in the peripheral tissues and the liver, and so a deficiency leads to cholesterol accumulation everywhere. And so you'll see early corneal arcus, and also kind of a nebular stromal haze that starts in childhood, and a lab work will show low HDL. So this is LCAT deficiency, pretty cloudy. They're labeling the limbus right here. Fischei disease and Tangier's disease. Next is tyrosinemia. This is autosomal recessive. This is another enzyme defect of tyrosine aminotransferase leading to excess tyrosine in the blood and urine. And so patients will have hyperkeratotic lesions on their palms, soles, and elbows, and then eventual mental retardation. Symptoms will include marked photophobia, tearing, conjunctival injection, tarsal papillary hypertrophy, pseudodendrites that do not stain well, and then recurrences will lead to corneal neovascularization and scarring. You could consider in a young child with recurrent HSV keratitis. The problem is HSV keratitis is way more common than tyrosinemia, but tyrosinemia would be bilateral. HSV keratitis, more rare to be bilateral. So this is what this looks like. See kind of central corneal clouding there. Central corneal clouding, patchy with some peripheral neovascularization. So yeah, this could look like HSV keratitis too. Lab work, to diagnose it, you'll see high tyrosine in the blood and urine with normal phenylalanine levels. And a biopsy will be showing soluble tyrosine aminotransferase deficiency. Treatment will be restricting the dietary intake of tyrosine and phenylalanine, and that can reduce the corneal and systemic changes, including mental status, because it can lead to mental retardation over time. Alkaptonuria is another autosomal recessive deficiency where there's a deficient enzyme that degrades tyrosine and phenylalanine. Is accumulation of a homogenotic acid that oxidizes and polymerizes into alkapton, which is a brown-black material similar to melanin. And you can get ochronosis, which is deposition of alkapton into the connective tissues. Clinical findings are arthropathy, renal calculi, pigmentation of the cartilaginous structures. On the eye, there'll be pigmentation of the medial rectus and lateral rectus tendons and of the sclera adjacent to the tendon insertions, and there'll be darkly pigmented dots in the corneal epithelium or Bowman's near the limbus. Lab work, there's urine that turns dark on standing and alkalinization, and homogenotic acid oxidase deficiency, and gene therapy is being investigated. So I have some pictures here. Picture of the pigment deposition around the tendon, rectus tendon insertion. And you can also see the deposition at Bowman's layer at the limbus. Ehlers-Danlos, this is a little bit more common. There are greater than 20 types. These are defects in collagen synthesis. So there's joint hyperextensibility and easy bruisability. Ehlers-Danlos type 6 has ocular involvement. It is autosomal recessive. There's moderate joint and skin involvement. They have brittle corneas that are easily ruptured, blue sclera, keratoconus, keratoglobus, and severe scoliosis. So this is type 6 with keratoglobus, and you can see a blue sclera there. And this is severe scleral thinning in a patient that was seen after strabismus surgery. Marfan syndrome, more common, this is autosomal dominant, and this occurs from defects in the fibrillin synthesis in the extracellular matrix, and that leads to a lot of other systemic findings, aortic root dilatation and aortic aneurysms, pectus excavatum and kyphoscoliosis, scleral thinning, ectopia lentis. Usually the subluxation is supratemporal, when subluxation. Corneal flattening is seen, so this is kind of in contrast to Ehlers-Danlos where you see steepening. In 20% of patients, the average corneal thickness or corneal steepness will be actually less than 35 diopters. Megalocornea and keratoconus are uncommon. So this is ectopia lentis and Marfan syndrome, so you can see the edge of the dislocated lens, and so it's dislocating supratemporal, you can see that more here. And so there's another syndrome which I don't think I talk about here, this homocystinuria, where the lens dislocates infranasal, which is kind of the opposite. So the way I think of it is like Marfans, they're like, people are really tall, and so like they're like this, it's like up and out. I don't know, that's how I think of it. They're just silly little things I use to like remember like doing tests. So up and out, Marfan syndrome. And then homocystinuria is the other one. It's like the opposite. It's down and in. Congenital systemic conditions. So we're moving away from the inherited systemic conditions. So these are genetic, but they're not necessarily inherited. Down syndrome, congenital syphilis, Wagner syndrome, and Goldenhar syndrome. So Down syndrome is trisomy 21, as we all know. So up to 30% will have keratoconus. And they actually may present with acute corneal high drops, and there's a big correlation with eye rubbing. Collagen cross-linking may be the best treatment, and with keratoconus, that's kind of a whole other talk, so I'm not really going to get into keratoconus quite so much, but just know that there's a high association with Down syndrome. So this is showing what sign?
Munson.
Yes, Munson sign. So Munson sign, you have steepening of the cornea that's so steep that it indents the lower lid when they look down. And this is corneal high drops where keratoconus gets so bad that decimase, it gets so steep that the decimase membrane actually ruptures, and so all the aqueous comes rushing into the corneal stroma, and that's what all this haziness is. Next, congenital syphilis. Signs can be present at birth, but it usually manifests later on in life, 5 to 20 years old, and the most common finding is interstitial keratitis. So interstitial keratitis symptoms include pain, tearing, redness, and photosensitivity. You'll see stromal infiltrates and edema. Late findings will include progressive vascularization into the central cornea that regress into ghost vessels, and this will be typically bilateral. There are many other causes of interstitial keratitis, including Cogan syndrome, EBV, HSV, leprosy, lupus, Lyme disease, and TB. So here's some examples of interstitial keratitis. So this is active interstitial keratitis and Cogan's disease. You see kind of stromal haziness and lots of neovascularization. And this is congenital syphilis with that's inactive interstitial keratitis with, you can see these ghost vessels without any blood. Wagner syndrome, so this stands for Wilms tumor, which is nephroblastoma, aniridia, genitourinary abnormalities, and mental retardation. So this occurs from a deletion of the short arm of chromosome 11, which often includes the PAX6 gene, and the size of the deletion varies. It's pretty uncommon. The incidence is 1 in 500,000 to about 1 in a million. With the aniridia, the name is a little bit, the name suggests no iris, but there's always some peripheral portion of the iris present. And with aniridia, it's associated with limbal stem cell deficiency, macular and optic nerve hypoplasia, glaucoma, and cataracts. So this is a picture of aniridia. So it looks like dilated pupils. So this is a patient who's not dilated. So you can just see remnants of iris tissue in the periphery. Next is Goldenhar syndrome. So this is also known as oculoauriculovertebral syndrome. This is an anomalous development of the first and second branchial arches. It's an unknown cause and may be genetic in some cases. It's associated with limbal dermoids, preauricular skin tags, strabismus, scoliosis, and hearing loss. Incidence is 1 in 3,500 to 1 in 26,000, slightly more males than females. And these are the preauricular skin tags, and this is a pretty classic limbal dermoid that's seen. And so the treatment of this, you can either leave it alone or you can kind of shave it down and then do a partial thickness corneal patch graft over on top. So this is a whole list of acquired systemic conditions. So a lot of these are going to be more common and things that you actually see in clinic and in consults.
Can they reoccur?
They typically don't. They can, but they typically don't. Yeah. Because they're actually not really progressive. They're usually just there at birth and they kind of stay there. So diabetes, corneal sequelae of diabetes, you all know it's dry eye. You can also get neurotrophic corneas that leads to poor epithelial healing and neurotrophic keratitis. And this is showing a neurotrophic ulcer, and the classic look, this is the classic look of a neurotrophic ulcer. So it's a little bit inferior, paracentral, it's kind of horizontally oval, and it's got these kind of heat up thickened gray-white edges. So this is very classic of a neurotrophic ulcer. Hypercholesterolemia can lead to lipid deposition in the peripheral cornea, leading to ARCUS. So early onset ARCUS is suspicious for high cholesterol. And there's dense ARCUS. So on the slit lamp exam, the ARCUS is kind of more in the stroma, whereas with the Kaiser Fleischer ring, it was deep. It was at decimase membrane. So yeah, I think you on slit lamp exam, you should be able to tell if they have both. Gout, you get elevated uric acid levels in the blood and deposition of monosodium urate crystals throughout the body, including the eyes. The crystals occur in the corneal epithelium and stroma, as well as you can get conjunctivitis, episcleritis, and scleritis. So these are urate crystals in the corneal stroma here. And this is nodular episcleritis, which you can, and gout is in the differential of episcleritis. Sleep apnea is associated with floppy eyelid syndrome and keratoconus. And this is a pretty classic floppy eyelid syndrome, so you just kind of try and raise the eyelid up and it moves way, way more than it should. So then you have to ask, you know, about sleep apnea symptoms, get them over to their PCP and get them tested for sleep apnea. Autoimmune conditions, there's several. I'm just going to highlight some of them. Rheumatoid arthritis can lead to dry eye, peripheral ulcerative keratitis, or essential paracentral thinning, which can actually lead to perforation. They can get scleromalacia perforans, which is non-necrotizing, or a necrotizing scleritis. Wegener's is associated with necrotizing scleritis, and with Sjögren's syndrome, dry eye is the most predominant disease seen. So these are examples of the thinning that you can see with rheumatoid arthritis primarily. So this is kind of a small excavated area, and it's usually paracentral, and I tend to see thinning like this more than the classic PUK that you read about. I think it's more common to get actually paracentral thinning with rheumatoid arthritis, and these perforate really quickly. Patients don't really have too much pain with it until they perforate. And this is pretty severe peripheral ulcerative keratitis. This is advanced scleromalacia perforans in rheumatoid arthritis. You can see uvea coming out through the sclera. Notice that the eye is relatively quiet. With necrotizing scleritis, it's very angry, very inflamed. And there you see thin, very, very thin sclera. Here's a few medication-related findings. So corneal vitreous elata, which we talked about earlier with Fabry's disease, these are going to be the more common medication-related causes of vitreous elata, with amiodarone being the most common, just because this is a lot more common of a medication. But you could, in theory, also see it with chloroquine, chlorpromazine, and indomethacin. Corneal edema, we can see with amantadine. So anyone who is on, if you see bilateral corneal edema, kind of look through their med list, see what they're on, and amantadine can be a cause. And amantadine's used for, I think, Parkinson's and dementia, but I think it's also being used for epilepsy and psych issues too.
Can you also see with hydroxychloroquine?
I don't think so. Yeah. Cataracts. We all know about steroids causing PSC cataracts. There's also a particular type of cataract that you can see with phenothiazine or thorazine. This is not really used commonly. So this is, again, corneal vitreous elata. This was with amiodarone. These are stellate thorazine deposits that are beneath the anterior lens capsule. And this is a classic PSC cataract, which you'll see with steroids. Hyperthyroidism, so you can get proptosis leading to exposure keratopathy. You can also get superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis with hyperthyroidism. So this is a very, very severe form of proptosis, and you can imagine that there's going to be chronic corneal exposure from this. With SLK, it's associated with thyroid dysfunction 30% of the time. And you can see inflammation of the superior bulbar and torsal conjunctiva, fluorescein staining of the superior corneal limbus, and you can pretty commonly see filaments, especially superiorly in the cornea. Typically, people develop this later on in life, on the sixth decade, usually more in females. The etiology is likely from eyelid laxity causing excessive friction. So here are some pictures here. You can see the injection of the conjunctiva superiorly. So if you don't lift up the lid, you're not going to see SLK. And here's some lissamine green staining. You'll see some staining on the superior bulbar conj, and here are filaments superiorly. Treatment is typically with topical lubrication, punctal plugs, restasis. A bandage contact lens can be used. You can do argon laser cautery of the superior bulbar conj. In the past, sodium nitrate was applied. I don't think people typically do that so much anymore. A content type or resection or recession is also performed. Exacerbations tend to be recurrent, but also tend to diminish with time. Yeah.
So in our cloudy eyelid patients, should we also be looking out for SLK?
I'm trying to think if there's a particular association. I don't know if those are typically associated. I can't really think of that. Yeah. I think in theory it could be because of friction, but I'm not sure if I've really seen it with the poppy eyelid. Next is monoclonal gammopathy, or that includes multiple myeloma. So you'll see bilateral corneal crystalline deposits of immunoglobulin origin. Diagnosis is by SPEP and bone marrow biopsy. So here are some examples of crystalline keratopathy that you see with multiple myeloma pre and post treatment. So this is pre treatment, post treatment. Not sure if that's better, but this one's definitely better. You can see pre and post. Next is hyperparathyroidism. You'll see band keratopathy that results from the hypercalcemia. And it looks like any other band keratopathy. So if there's band keratopathy going on and there's no cause that you can see in the eye, like the patient hasn't had, you know, chronic glaucoma or other chronic eye disease, then or chronic inflammation, might want to work up the patient for hyperparathyroidism. They have calcium deposits throughout the body. They can have decreased vision from their band keratopathy, foreign body sensation, and recurrent erosions. And you want to treat the band keratopathy with EDTA chelation. So here's some classic picture of band keratopathy here. So you'll see a band of calcium kind of across the central or inferior portion of the cornea. And with hyperparathyroidism, you can see actually calcium deposits on the lid margin too. Next is amyloidosis. This is another systemic deposition. Pathology is going to be staining of the amyloid with Congo red dye and with dichroism and birefringence. See here. Right there. There's several forms of amyloidosis. So there's like primary localized disease, primary systemic, and then secondary localized and secondary systemic. So with primary localized disease, it's the most common form of the ocular disease. And this includes gelatinous drop-like dystrophy, which is familial, colitis dystrophy, and polymorphic amyloid degeneration. Then there's primary systemic disease, where they get kind of waxy ecchymotic eyelid papules. Secondary localized is the most common form of corneal disease. And this occurs with long-standing chronic inflammatory disease. They can get a degenerative pannus, yellowish pink or yellow gray lamellar deposits, and a deep stroma. With secondary systemic disease, eye involvement is uncommon. So this is a picture of severe chemosis with amyloid deposition and associated subconscious heme. And these are amyloid deposits that are infiltrating the conjunctiva and cornea. Vitamin A deficiency, so we suspect this in poor nutrition. People have with poor nutrition, such as alcoholics or post-gastric bypass patients. Night blindness is the first symptom, and they get xerophthalmia, which is severe dry eye, with Betos spots, which I'll show a picture of, and keratinization of the cornea. And these represent a squamous metaplasia of the conjunctiva. In severe forms, that could lead to corneal melting from necrosis of collagen. So this is a picture of a Betos spot. My silly way of kind of remembering that Betos spots look like this is it looks like a bundle of spit. So it's like Betos, you're like spitting. So that's how I remember that. Keratinization of the cornea here. So you get, with vitamin A deficiency, you get a mucin deficiency because it kind of destroys the goblet cells, and that leads to decreased tear breakup time. Treatment, obviously, with vitamin A, so that can be high-dose oral supplementation or IM injections of vitamin A. And that's it.